Hey there, everybody. I am joined by Steve. Say hello, Steve.
Hey, everybody. And
we're here to talk about Star Trek. Is it Star Trek CCG, right?
Right, the Star Trek customizable card game.
So this is a game I've dipped my toes in a little bit. I think I have like a foil bridge crew. I like Star Trek. I'm not a Trekkie, but it seems like a really cool game to collect and a cool game to play. So Steve, do you kind of want to give us a primer here?
Yeah, I thought I'd talk a little bit about what's interesting about this game and why it might appeal to people who play other out-of-print CCGs, particularly if you play Star Wars CCG or the Lord of the Rings TCG, why you might like this game. The first thing that's interesting about this game is that it came out in 1994, so just about a year after the CCG as a concept premiered with Magic the Gathering. It's a really early CCG. It was Decipher's first, Decipher Incorporated, the company that made Star Wars, Lord of the Rings, others, was their first collectible card game. It was pretty experimental in that way. And it exists in two editions, a first and a second edition. But taken together, Decipher produced Star Trek CCG from 1994 until, I think, maybe my year, right, I think it was until 2006, 2007. But right when they finished making,
years.
Yes. The last year they produced CCGs, they were, you know, it was Lord of the Rings, was at the tail end of it, the finishing out, and this game, Star Trek CCG. So from the beginning to the end of Decipher's card game producing time. So it's really, really interesting game. So a couple of things about it. It is extremely immersive game. It's very, basically anything that you can imagine yourself doing in Star Trek that ever appeared in an episode or movie up through the time they had the license, there is a card for it. Even if it's not something that like makes a ton of sense why you do it in a game, like if you've seen Star Trek IV, The Voyage Home, like, you know, the crew goes back in time to the 1980s to rescue some whales and bring them to the future and all this stuff. You can do that in this game. Like, I don't know if it's like strategically usually very good idea to do it, but they have all the mechanics for it.
So can I jump in and just say, yeah, you know, as someone who thinks about these card games quite a bit, it's interesting because I think that the model in the 90s was so experimental where mm-hmm. you were just trying to do cool stuff like, you mm-hmm. know, freeze Han in Star Wars mm-hmm. CCG or whatever. And then like, you know, now we see like it's been refined where it turns out that everybody just wants a 15-minute card game. Like, you know, a modern Magic game is like 15 minutes long, yeah, right? And so we've gone from like, because I think Star Trek is like what, like an hour game?
I think it goes well beyond that sometimes. Yeah, a lot of tournament games time out.
Yeah, you go from like what is essentially a board game with cards to like what actually people want in a card shop is something they can play for 10 to 15 minutes, right? So it's just an interesting where we've kind of evolved to. But I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's absolutely right, Matt. I mean, I think with this game, you really see the role-playing and board gaming roots of CCGs. Like, really, right? Magic was designed to be something you played between rounds of D&D at a convention. This game is like, it's the most like playing a role-playing game or even someone's like a Euro board game of any CCG. Let me talk a little bit about, I guess, the mechanics from like a bird's eye view and makes it different than other card games. I mean, one of the main things that's interesting about it is that it simulates a Star Trek episode or movie. Like you feel like you are running your own Star Trek episode. What I mean by that is that there's combat is really not central to this game. It's really the only card game I think I've ever played in which combat plays a pretty supporting role. I mean, I'd say that in games I've played recently, battles only happen maybe every other game, maybe every third game. It's about exploring the universe and attempting missions. So like, yeah, you win by scoring 100 points, being the first player to score 100 points. And you score points in a number of ways, but primarily through accomplishing missions. And I'll pull up a mission card here to show everybody. A mission is a place in the Star Trek universe. Cool. And a thing to do, and I'll talk a little bit more about them later. So you're laying out these missions at the beginning of the game to form kind of the universe that you explore. And each time you go to a mission, there's going to be some complications that arise under the mission. And the cards are called dilemmas, which your opponent has seeded at the beginning of the game under your missions, and you've seeded some under his missions. So it kind of feels a little bit like an episode of Star Trek where, you know, Picard, Riker, and Data, for instance, beam down to a planet to, I don't know, like deliver medical supplies or negotiate a treaty or something. And then something crazy happens. And that's the plot of the episode. And that's what you do at each of these missions, is have these kind of unexpected things happen, have to react to it. The game, the characters are principally, it's skills that are important on them, not so much like their strength in combat, although they do have those kind of attributes. So your character cards, and I'll show them, are like, here's Spock, for instance, who's got a lot of skills. You know, he's got science, computer skill, exobiology, music, officer, mind meld, and then a few other like special skills, special abilities there. And so you use these skills to accomplish the missions and to overcome dilemmas. So it's kind of, when you're building your deck, figuring out what the right mix of skills you want in your deck. And then during the game, trying to figure out a little bit of a gambling kind of idea too. Like, okay, do I have the right skills to accomplish this mission? You know what's on the mission card, but you don't know what unforeseen dilemmas might be hidden underneath it. I should take a moment to say, you know, there's these two editions. There's a first and a second edition of the game. And we can, depending on how we go on this discussion, we talk about the reason why there's two versions. But basically, they're totally different games. They have some related features and mechanics to them, but they play separately from each other. The first edition is what I primarily play and collect, although I do have some second edition. So I'll probably be mostly talking about the first edition in this game, in this video. It's the more simulationist, it's, I think, a more complicated game. A little the rules are a little more fiddly, I guess.
So can I just jump in quick and, sure, and ask, you know, when, because I've noticed this trend within games where it seems like right at the 6 to 7 year mark is when most of these games that came out in the 90s either get a relaunch or get like a second edition, right? Was this kind of also, I mean, either they go out like Star Wars CCG, it made it 6 years, you know, then it was like a second edition either would have happened, right? Or the game, you know, the game went out of print. And it seems like, was that sort of also
it's around trend? That time. I just confirmed it. I think it's 2002 when the second edition came out. It so was
like a little longer, but Nemesis. Roughly that time.
Yeah. And I think it probably they began developing it around the 6 year mark. And yes, they were given some of the reasons for that, but the game, it kind of snowballed and got more and more complex. There were some
start to have to introducing cards to counter other cards, and then banning cards. It just becomes like very complex. You need to think about like the history of like six bands, and then like, are people even going to run this in the meta anymore?
Exactly. Like with Star Wars, some of the later first edition sets had some overpowered and broken cards, and because Decipher didn't do ban lists ever, it became really hard to manage the game, I think. And so they decided to start fresh with a new edition, and that kept a lot of the concepts of it. But the main thing with the second edition, I won't go into too much, is that it probably is a better card game in some ways, but it doesn't feel to me as much like playing an episode of Star Trek. It feels like a very good mission solving card game with a Star Trek overlay over it in some ways. Okay. So that's not to knock the game. It's a good game, has a lot of fans still, but I prefer the first edition.
Do you think the first edition sort of like where collectors, like, is that more interest from collectors in the first edition? Is that
Probably so. I haven't looked at the prices of second edition lately, but the last time I looked, first edition cards still, the big ones still sold for a good bit more money than second edition cards. I think maybe like Lord of the Rings, the last two or so second edition expansions were short printed. I think the last expansion for Star Trek CCG might have only been sold on Category 1 games. So it might be like
the Hills. There's like the wholesaler.
It might have been Hills Wholesale, not Category 1. But yeah, on Hills Wholesale. So I think that one might be a little harder to find some value to it. But yeah, I think the nostalgia is there for the first edition of the game. And without fail, anytime anyone pops onto the forums and is like, hey, I've got this old shoebox of Star Trek cards when I was a kid, what's to do with these? It's always the first edition that they're pulling
out.
I think by the second edition time, it was more like the devoted fan base that was still playing it, but it wasn't as many casual players.
Okay, so we're going. I think you're at kind of the history of the game.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to interrupt there.
No, let me just going back to 1994. Some of the things that are interesting about this game that make it unique is that, well, one really weird thing about it is there is no resource mechanic in this game. What I mean by that is if you pull out like...
There's no mana, there's no force,
You pull out like a person, the character's called personnel.
Okay.
Right? And this personnel has no cost. there's no deploy cost, mana cost, anything like that. That is changed in the second edition. But I guess, I don't know exactly why the designers didn't put a cost on anything, but the mechanic of it is you can play one card every turn. You can draw one card every turn, you can play one card every turn. And that's that. But I probably already see the problem with this is like you get, you know, Jean-Luc Picard, for instance. He costs one card to play and he has a lot of skills and he's very good. But so then why would anyone ever want to run like Ensign No Name, some random background character that has, you know, maybe one or two skills? In the beginning of the game, it was like those cards were extremely useless, unless for some reason that one skill was not very common. So without a resource mechanic, it made for games a little bit strange, I guess. That coupled with the fact that they, in the first set, released a card that called Red Alert, which lets you play as many cards as you want on a turn. So many games in the beginning became a hunt to pull out this card, lets you then break the entire resource mechanic and play as many cards as you want every turn. But anyway, that's some of the experimentalness of the game. Now, the other thing about it that's, I think, you know, there's, as they're making the sets, they are realizing some of the ideas in the beginning that maybe didn't work out as well as planned. So more so than any other game I've played at like the third or fourth expansion set, there's almost like a soft reboot of this game where they introduce a bunch of new rules and both new rules and magic bullet cards that, that kind of bend everything and make everything sort of work better without getting into a ton of details on it. And so it's timed with the movie First Contact, Star Trek First Contact. They released the First Contact set, which makes the game play faster. It includes like a tutoring mechanic that's printed on cards. It changes up the resource things to allow you to play more than one card per turn, but not infinite cards per turn. So there's a real sweet spot in the game through like the middle sets. And the other thing to note about the game is originally it's called the Star Trek The Next Generation collectible or customizable card game because they only had the license for TNG. Mm. And so they only actually planned for the game to go like four or five sets. Because they thought that's all you could do with the Next Generation. So it would be a kind of a closed board game-like experience, like five sets and done. But they were able to negotiate for the rest of the Star Trek franchise. And so in like 96 or 97, they begin releasing, First Contact, and they go to Deep Space Nine. And from there, they go through the rest of the franchise, really opening up the possibilities.
Interesting.
Another thing, yeah, go ahead.
No, mine, go ahead.
The other thing I would just say is, unlike Star Wars, there's no light side and dark side. There's no like different card backs. Everything has got just one Star Trek icon card back.
Which, and I feel like they accidentally did that right. They didn't have like different factions because it turns out that was the right way to go as far as card backs.
It is, and yeah, unlike Lord of the Rings, there's no like half your deck is not good guys and bad guys. Is that you have affiliations, and so. Like you can see on Benjamin Sisko here, he's got the blue star, Federation trim around there, makes him Federation. Yep. Kira from Deep Space Nine, she's Bajoran, so she's got the Bajoran coloring, and so on. Klingons were in the game from the beginning, like a kind of nice red to them. And you can go with decks that are either just one affiliation, which is the most straightforward. Or you can combine them using treaty cards, which will then allow you to mix and match under certain conditions. That's where a lot of interesting pairings of different characters from across the franchise.
So let's kind of jump ahead a little bit here. Mm-hmm. So, first edition, if I want to start playing this or collecting it, maybe we'll do a whole separate video on collecting because really hot topic that I think is people interested in. But Just curious, if I want to start just playing this or getting into this, what's sort of the on-ramp or like the vehicle?
Yeah, well, I think like Star Wars and Lord of the Rings, there is a players committee that keeps the game going, and they manage both the first and second edition of the game, and they release new virtual expansions. So I would definitely direct people to the continuing committee is what it's called. Their website is trekcc.org as a first stop, just to poke around. I think so. Unlike the Star Wars CCG, the Star Trek CCG, you can actually proxy and print all cards in the game, including the old ones. So you don't actually have to track down the old cards. You can, if you want to just try out the game, you can just print off. I think they have some demo decks on there to look at. But presuming, I prefer having physical cards, presuming you want to collect and like actually have the game as was originally printed, I would actually probably recommend starting with the premiere set, even though I kind of like talked about how there were some broken elements to it in the beginning and it's not as fully developed as later expansions. It is a pretty good, almost like board game like environment, and it's also quite inexpensive. And I think it's more fun to play premiere only Star Trek CCG than it is to play premiere only Star Wars CCG. I find kind of dull, and the broken elements kind of like people who know to exploit them kind of ruin that game to me, at least for Star Wars. For Star Trek, the broken elements are almost more like quirky in a way. It plays like a Star Trek board game, I'd say.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Yeah. Cause I mean, I think that playing Premiere, you have to know what the broken elements are, but playing Star Wars Premiere, it's like, this is horrible. This is a terrible format to play.
And you don't even have not all the main characters are even in Star Wars Premiere, and it's only the first movie and so forth. But Star Trek CCG, the Premiere set, covers the entire 7 seasons of The Next Generation. It's got the entire bridge crew in it. It's a pretty good set. Like, and it's also very cheap. We can talk about more collecting later, but I just looked it up. I think you can get booster boxes of White Border Star Trek Premiere for $25, I think, still.
That's fantastic. I mean,
not bad. A couple boosters, you probably have boxes. You probably have a whole set or close to it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's a good price. So like, there's an affordability there.
Yeah.
So tell me I was just going to ask about the continuing committee, right? Mm-hmm. I think the Star Wars PC I'm pretty familiar with, but I'm a little less so with the continuing committee. Do you kind of want to show the website and kind of what that?
Yeah, looks sure. Like you actually used to volunteer a lot more with them in the past when I've been. Various things have cut a little too busy lately, but they're a really good organization. Like the Star Wars Players Committee, they produce virtual expansions, and they run tournaments, both in person and online tournaments. You can play Star Trek CCG online via Lackey, which is a platform for playing a lot of different games, and they unlike GEMP, there's no rules enforcement on there because it's, I think it would be harder probably to do rules enforcement this game. But anyway, it's good. It's a good platform to play on. And there's tournaments for both the first and second edition pretty regularly, like once a month, once every other month. Probably a little smaller than the Star Wars Players Committee, but it's still they're pretty passionate. They release expansions like on a really good clip, like 2 or 3 a year for both games. And the expansions, virtual expansions, they're cool because I think how they've decided to do it is they use images from the shows and movies, provided they don't they don't use anything from, they use material that Decipher had the license to. So they won't go anything into the J.J. Abrams films or the Paramount Plus TV series as of yet. But the card, yeah, they're very professional done. So I'll pull up a couple cards here, just a dilemma they produced. Like, it's pretty much indistinguishable, the virtual cards from the ones that Decipher made. They're so professionally done.
I mean, that's what I like about players committees is they take these games that otherwise, like, I think if you don't have something continuing to think about it and hold tournaments.
Yeah,
it can just go into the dustbin really quick, right?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Need
something to stimulate them. If you're a living card game, you're going to have releases, right? You're going to have tournaments, and that's all exciting. But you really have to find ways of generating energy for old stuff. Otherwise, it's truly just I found a shoebox of cards, and people are like forming because there's valuable cards in there, right? That's just not sustainable.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Yeah, definitely agree with that. And I think the virtual cards, I feel like with Star CCG, there's a bit of debate among some people about whether to use them or not. I feel like the Star Trek CCG virtual cards are almost more of a natural evolution of the first edition. Well, actually, and second edition. So they continued producing virtuals for like both of the family trees. Mm-hmm. And it feels more like it feels to me just like if a Decipher were to had continued the game for decades longer. Part of that's probably because I think they actually had for a long time one of the original designers designing virtual cards for them on a voluntary basis. I think on a voluntary basis, yeah. So, give them a check, give them a look if you're interested in getting involved with the game.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm curious. I think that there's like once again it hits that sort of sweet spot for me where mm-hmm. there's one, it's iconic IP, right, that everybody loves. Mm-hmm. Two, the cards look great, right?
They do.
They look. You know, because there's a lot of these 90s card games that just like don't look nice. Yes. And Decipher created really crisp products. So you have great looking characters, great IP. And then also you have some sort of community around it still. Mm-hmm. Like, there are some of these also games that like there's seven people that follow it. It's not sustainable. And so it hits all three of those. So I think that for me, that's sort of like that piques my interest.
Definitely. Right. The design of the cards is a good point you made. As I think I was listening to a different podcast recently about the design for Decipher. And I guess Warren Holland, the CEO of Decipher, he was like very big on design. I think he maybe had a design background of some sort, but he enforced the fact these cards need to look really good. And they also like the designers, they reached out to the production staff of Star Trek. If you're a Star Trek fan, you probably know the names like Denise and Michael Okuda, who managed like the Star Trek Encyclopedia and the chronology, and also did a lot of like prop work on the shows. And like the designers of this game reached out to them to get clarifications on certain things and to get like better images or to figure out like where they should look for certain shots. That's a level of care that I do not think the level of the 90 CCGs did with the source material.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think a lot of them were just like truly racing to pump out sets, mm-hmm. right? And the 90s and early 2000s were such a weird time for games, right? There was just a ton out there. They're all competing, and most of them aren't going to make it. Most of them, I mean, everything except Magic failed in Pokemon.
Right. Yeah.
So, well, this has been really fun, Steve. If you've gotten this far, please leave your comments and your thoughts. We'd love to hear kind of questions. I think we're doing a follow-up video kind of talking about the collectability of this mm-hmm. stuff and, you know, what to collect, what's the cool stuff. Decipher mm-hmm. also did reflections for this. Somebody that said that whenever Decipher released a reflection set, it meant they were running out of money. There's always just like a pretty blatant money grab.
Yeah.
So... Yeah. We can kind of get into more of that in a collecting video, but this has been a really great primer. So thanks so much for taking the time to chat, Steve. And we'll see everybody next time.
Thanks.